I want you guys to know we're debating Simon Fitz. And he has already stated that he does believe it's possible for God to exist. So you guys have heard of the ontological argument that it is possible for a maximally great being to exist. And it's possible for a maximally great being to exist in some possible world. So if a maximally great being exists in some possible world, then it exists in the actual world. I like Anselm's ontological argument. I really do. So what an atheist would have to show is that it's impossible for God to exist. But already my atheist friend Simon has said that he does believe that God can exist, that it is possible. Let me give you some other reasons why atheism just doesn't make sense. Objective moral values. Here's the argument, and I'll put a note here. I'm going to give him some that he'll enjoy talking about. If God does not exist, then objective moral values would not exist. But objective moral values do exist. It therefore follows logically that God exists. When we say objective moral values, what we mean are values that are valid and binding whether anyone agrees with them or not. So, for example, to say what Hitler did was evil is to say that it is evil even if you were Hitler himself when he killed all the Jews. Now, the problem, though, is on atheism, and this is why atheism is declining worldwide as a whole and why theists rule the world. The problem on atheism is atheists want to say certain things are evil, but then they say there's no such thing as objective moral value, so they're kind of hypocritical. They contradict themselves. We all know that rape is wrong in all instances. Recently, I was debating an atheist, and he said that rape is subjective. And I said, well, then give me an example when it would be okay. And so I would like, don't forget, Simon, when you get on, if you could answer that question, do you believe that rape is objectively wrong? You might want to write that down. And then we also have the cosmological argument I'm going to talk about next. But on objective moral values, you hear atheists saying certain things are evil and certain things are good, but on atheism, why would things be good and evil if all we are evolved animals? See, on atheism, you can't ground your objective moral values on anything because, after all, you're just an atheist flesh blob. That's my new phrase, atheist flesh blob. So I gave him, we talked about objective moral values. Let's talk about the mind. You know, Simon, he chose to come in here. He has free will of the mind. He chose to come in here. But what we hear atheists saying is, no, we're just atheist flesh blobs, and everything is determined. We don't have free will. See, if you were an atheist flesh blob, then you wouldn't have free will. It'd just be your cells moving around and your brain telling you what to do. But because you can choose to come in here, we got 25 people in here, all you guys chose to come in here. You're not an atheist flesh blob. This shows there's something else besides just the brain, just cells and matter in motion. You have a mind. Remember Christopher Reeves, guys, when Christopher Reeves got on the accident with the horse, and he said that his mind wanted so bad to get up and walk, but because he was handicapped, his brain couldn't send the signals and stuff. So there's a difference between your mind and your brain. When you are happy, your brain's not all happy. You are happy. Your mind, your state of mind is happy. When you are sad, your brain's not sad. You are sad. This goes against atheist naturalism, where atheists say all there is a natural world. What about ghost or demonic activity? I would like to ask people in the room here, does anyone in here know someone that has experienced demonic activity or ghost in their life? We have 27 people in here now, and I guarantee you, and we already have one person saying me, and here's another person saying they've experienced it, Every single person in here knows someone or has experienced someone that has had a ghost or demonic activity. But this is not a natural phenomenon. This shows that there's something to the spiritual world. We had a husband and wife paranormal investigation team come in here, and the lady was saying that she totally believes that some of them are very evil. This also adds more proof and evidence on the side of Christianity being true, God's existence. It shows that there's something else besides the natural world. And now let's mosey on to the universe. Atheists got it wrong. Atheists, in the past, the atheists believed that the universe was eternal and uncaused, and the Christians were saying, no, God created the universe. The universe had a beginning. So the atheists were saying it was eternal and uncaused. The Christians were saying, no, it had a beginning. Now with modern science, guess what? The atheists are wrong. All evidence now shows that the universe has a beginning. Whatever begins to exist has a cause. The universe began to exist. Therefore, the universe has a cause. What is that cause? And by the way, where's that one guy that I was... Let me scroll down here. Simon, here's another question for you. What do you think created the universe? Well, it can't be a material cause because there was no matter, energy, even time had to be created. It follows rationally that the cause had to be something timeless, something that exists necessarily. There's only really two things you can argue that are like that, by the way, like an abstract object, like the number 7, for example. Some people believe numbers exist necessarily. Or a powerful mind, just like what we were talking about earlier, you know, how you can choose to do something, you can choose to create. But it doesn't follow rationally that the number 7, like a abstract object, created the universe. The number 7, for example, is powerless. But I would like to ask you guys something right now. In your mind, think of a giant elephant. Now, you got it? You got a picture there in your mind? When you die, if the doctors had an autopsy on you, they wouldn't find that elephant. Yet you created that with your mind. See, the mind can create. The number 7 is powerless. It follows rationally that the cause of the universe must be uncaused. It must be eternal, something that exists necessarily. And it can't be material because all matter, space, time, and energy came into existence. It's not eternal. So I would also like to ask Simon to talk about that. What does he think created the universe? Because we know that atheists are wrong and Christians have now been vindicated. The atheists were saying the universe is eternal and uncaused. All evidence shows the Christians were right all along. The universe has a beginning, and I'm positing that the creator is God. It's not like Lawrence Krauss says, nothing. And then we have the prophecies in Scripture. I'll hit on that. The prophecies in Scripture that came true. And we know that and I'm almost done, Princess. I think I'll wrap it up a little earlier here because I'm going to give them some easy things to talk about. We know that prophecies in Scripture have come true. Look at the prophecy, the 1948 prophecy of Israel being gathered again to herself. We know that the proof and evidence of Jesus Christ's existence is there. All the Gospels say that the women were the first at the tomb. Well, you know, women's testimony was not even valid in that culture and time frame. So you have a level of embarrassment that adds to the credibility of the empty tomb. In fact, most historians agree that the tomb was empty. We even have atheist scholars like Garth Ludeman admitting that the disciples did have experiences in which Jesus appeared to them as the risen Christ. You have the empty tomb, you have the women and all the Gospels saying that the tomb was empty. You have a radical, dramatic explosion of Christianity immediately, so there was not enough time for legend theory to develop. And also, you got prophecies that have come true in Scripture. Let's go through a few more things, and then I'll wrap it up. Near-death experiences also adds weight to there being a spiritual realm. You know, my mom, as you guys know, recently had surgery on her hip and stuff, and I was able to talk to doctors and nurses there, and they totally believe in near-death experiences, and a lot of these doctors and nurses, very educated Christians, and they totally were telling me stories of how they believe in this near-death experience where you're actually able to go outside your body. There's something else besides naturalism. This is a huge wooden stake in the heart of atheist naturalism. And then also Christians experience God in their lives. We have what's called experiential reality. And unless someone can give me a defeater, someone has to give me an argument that would show that I'm irrational to deny my experience. So the Christians have experiential reality. DNA is also empirical proof of intelligent design. You should go to shotgunout.net, you guys, click music podcast. Any rational person that looks at DNA realizes that this is a language. It cannot evolve by purely natural processes. That is empirical proof of intelligent design. I got two more things we'll talk about. And here's why I left atheism and most people leave atheism. Do you know that studies show most people, as they grow up and they mature, they leave atheism? Most of the atheists, like when you're hanging out on YouTube and stuff, most of them are just kids, Santa syndrome. But the problem with atheism is this. There really is no objective purpose to an atheist's life. Atheists are a lot like bees. They try to sting you with their arguments, but in the end, they just die. And they die a purposeless life. There's no objective purpose to an atheist's life, just to live and just to die. But see, on Christianity, you can have a purpose to glorify God with every beat of your heart, to come to a closer relationship with God, to experience God in your life, to bring other people to the salvation and saving grace of Jesus Christ. The problem on atheism is it's just like, to be an atheist, you're like a candle in the wind. You're like a flower quickly fading. You're here today, gone tomorrow. You're like a wave tossed on the ocean, a ship without a rudder. It is madness in its purest form. The best that atheism can give you, not on my argument, every atheist will tell you this, the best that atheists can give you in the end is death. D-E-A-T-H, death. Because if you ask an atheist, what is the ultimate end of an atheist? The best that they can have is death. Now, sometimes an atheist will say, well, we plan on helping humanity. The problem, though, is science has already shown, and atheists and Christians agree, that unless God steps in, the universe is going to die and everything would end in death anyways. On the atheist worldview, you end up with death. Regardless of what all the dodo birds like Sam Harris, Richard Dawkins, Matt Dodo, and all these atheist clowns say, the problem is on their worldview, it ends in death, guys. Stinking, rotting, pathetic, death. And they'll tell you to your face that's what it ends in. Now, look at Christianity. Jesus Christ said, look, I've come to give you life and life more abundantly. Excuse me. He said, I wouldn't tell you if it wasn't true. In my Father's house, there's many mansions. So what you're going to see in this debate with my friend Simon here is he's not going to be able to give any arguments of why we should believe atheism is true. And it's not his fault. It's just he got pumped by atheism. Atheism has no proof and evidence that it's true. In fact, it is the atheist that believes in a view of which there is no evidence. That's why I left atheism. I don't have enough blind faith to be an atheist. Another reason why I left atheism is the horrible history of atheism, over 150 million brutal murders, rapes, and atrocities under the evil atheist regimes of Stalin, Mao, Pol Pot, Kim Jong-il, the Khmer Rouge, and more. And my parting comment is this, okay? My parting comment is this. Why do atheists always bash God, but they never bash Satan? You ever notice that? I'm going to tell you why, guys. Because it's rude to bash your father. Atheists always bash God, but they never bash Satan. I would tell you guys this. Let me leave it with this. When you really think about it, if there were no God, there would be no atheist. The atheists actually prove God exists by them being so obsessed with God. So thanks for your time, guys. I gave you, we talked about the mind, we talked about ghost demonic activity, objective moral values, the cosmological argument, the ontological argument. We talked about Jesus Christ, the empty tomb, etc. We talked about prophecies coming true, near-death experiences, extraterrestrial reality, DNA, no objective purpose in life. We talked about 10 arguments here. And what I would like to ask Simon, I'm going to get off the mic right now, and I even finished early. What I would like to ask Simon is this. What proof and evidence do you have that atheism is accurate and correct? So thanks for your time, and God bless you guys. And I'll sit back now, and I'll take notes, and I'll listen to all the proof and evidence, if any, that my atheist friend Simon can give me.
All right, well, thank you for having me here. And I'm going to try to kind of go in order here. So the first thing I had written down here is you asked, is race objectively wrong? And with that, objectively, no, it's not wrong. But we have developed certain morals over our evolutionary period from monkeys, yes. And it's in certain cultures there have been developed morals where you basically we've evolved to conform, and when we're put in a society where we think where everybody thinks rape is wrong, we will think rape is wrong. There are certain genetic factors, which I'll get to the language there. And I just want to say, you are a Christian eschblob in terms of atheism. We wouldn't call you an atheist eschblob, I'm sorry. One thing I want to clear up here is there are a lot of types of atheism, and my type of atheism isn't going to be comparable to the next guy. People might agree with me in some respects and then not agree with me in others. You have different types of religions that are organized, and they have multiple people in that have these same beliefs. Atheism, the point of it is that you're not an organized religion. Obviously, it is still a religion because it does require a bit of faith. And I definitely want to get rid of this notion of naturalism. Naturalism is not atheism. Atheism is not naturalism. Naturalism is purely a extremely blind faith religion. Well, what isn't? You're talking about the universe and how you say it came from nothing. And I want to, first of all, I'm not sure exactly what modern science is proving that the Big Bang Theory, which I believe is what you're referring, is wrong. But Big Bang Theory actually never says that the universe wasn't created, and we don't actually have any evidence to go back to a point where the Big Bang Theory occurred. That's just what we think it may have originated from, because we can only extrapolate to a point because using cosmology, we can and see how far galaxies are moving apart from each other, and then we bring that down towards billions and billions of years ago, and we can see, okay, this is where they might have been at this point in time. We don't know exactly how far we can extrapolate that, though, which is the problem there. And with mind's workings, I think that you're kind of confusing the mind's workings and the flesh blob idea. the mind is a series of on-off switches, and they will initiate other on-off switches. So eventually, over billions and billions of cells, you end up getting logic by saying, we've hit these on switches, and that would be like a visual signal. When it hits your retina, it's going to turn those on switches on, and then that's going to set off reaction inside the brain among those other on-off switches. And in terms of prophecies, the thing there is very confusing. My idea is that it's an interaction of multiple fluids, and that when we die, we don't actually completely go away until a point where all society forgets about us, because multiple fields are the fields around our heads, really, that we create, and it's the way that our mind affects the outside world. That's my thought on why during global disasters, these random number generators that have been set up around the world for years, they get less random around times of global disaster when people are all thinking alike, and that's how we're affecting our world, and that's a purpose that religion serves, which, so I by no means want to promote religion, I just don't truly believe in it. So, in terms of near-death experiences, I'm not sure exactly how you want me to respond to that, but I think that, yes, I've talked to people that have had near-death experiences and believe that they're outside their body, but that, to me, that makes me think of the morphic field again, where we're becoming into existence in other people's minds, and are outside in the area where what I suppose you could compare to a soul would be, and you would become part of that, and you can see outside your body. And in terms of the language of DNA, I'm not sure where it says that language cannot be created, because we can create language from almost anything. Created languages from pictures, from just symbols, hieroglyphics, Arabian numbers, and the lettering system. There are many different types of languages, so DNA does not necessarily have to be a language. It is a language that we can now understand, and we are putting that language into it. It's not necessarily a language of its own. It is just an amalgamation of atoms. And I want to say, religion, in terms of making it, basically, it's the opiate of the people, as Karl Marx said. Yes, he was the original communist, but his ideas were good. Unlike Stalin, those types of people who hijacked his theory. So he believed that religion was only there to serve as a giving purpose to people, and that's why I believe it does give purpose to people. And in terms of atheism, it will end in death, as will religion, or Christianity, Buddhism, Hinduism, any god religion. It will end in death either way. And in my version of atheism, I do believe that there is a life beyond death, but I don't necessarily believe that there will be a heaven or hell. It might be heaven or hell depending on what your point of view was in life, but it's different. And blind faith, every religion has to have blind faith. There's no way you can answer the number of whys that you could ask. I could just continually ask why, and there's no way you could continually answer those that fast enough straight. We'd die, and the Earth would explode before you can answer every single why. And in terms of never bashing Satan, personally, I never bash Satan, but I've also never bashed God, either. It's the idea of religion and organized religion that I've just chosen not to appeal to. And what proof of evidence is atheism correct, is your last question to me. Trying to wrap up here. And I think that there's really no proof for either side. The point of the debate between atheism and every other religion is that whatever makes you comfortable. So, personally, I want to go into science. Science makes me feel better about my knowledge, and atheism helps me advance that, I think. It may or may not, but it's just a thought, obviously. So, it's not about whether you're right or wrong, whether you believe in God or don't. It's whether you're comfortable in your own skin. So, I'd be good to adjust that, apparently. So, the evidence isn't there, but there's also no evidence for Christianity or any other religion. So, that's about it. Sorry, what's going on? I may have.
Alrighty. Hey, thanks for that. I wrote down everything you said. Hey, I was just going to ask you that, Princess. Is his mic making kind of unusual noise? I can kind of hear you, Simon, so don't worry about it. Just making sure it wasn't on my end. All right. Well, I want to thank Simon for coming in here and being so brutally honest. He said he isn't a religion, which is true. But let's go through some of the things that he said. First of all, when we asked him what proof and evidence can you provide that shows atheism is actually correct, he admitted there is no proof that atheism is correct. He says there's no evidence. I agree with him on that. Atheism is based on faith, but there is no faith or arguments for that. Now, when you play it back, you'll notice that Simon didn't give us any reason to think that God doesn't exist. In fact, Simon strengthened our belief in God even more. He brought up some things. He said, look, let me go through what he said. He said, yes, atheism will end in death. He said, but in his version of atheism, he believes there is life after death. Okay. And that's his right to believe that. Scripture does talk about a place where atheists go after they die in this world, and maybe in that sense, Simon and I can agree that the atheist could have something else eternal to live in. All right, let's see what else he says. Now, he says he likes science. I love science. In fact, Simon, most of the world's greatest scientists throughout world history, the majority of them confess to believing in God. The majority. And so I absolutely love science, too. Another thing that Simon said, he said the mind, he didn't deny that we have a mind, so the argument for the mind goes on my side of the debate. He talked to us about how the mind works. He says it's like on and off switches and stuff like that. And what I was really going for was to see if he would agree or disagree on us having a mind. And Simon and I agree that we have a mind. So that part of my argument goes unrefuted. That goes on my side of the debate. On prophecies, Simon, I wrote down what you said. I have to confess, I don't know if you understood what I was talking about. On the prophecies, I was talking about prophecies that actually came true. Like, there's a prophecy called the 1948 prophecy where it talks about Israel being gathered again to herself. No other country in world history has been gathered again as a sovereign nation to themselves like that in prophecy, like Israel did. There's no others. The prophecy of Isaiah of Jesus Christ, that's another prophecy where it talks about Jesus Christ and his them gambling for his garments. It talks about with his stripes we are healed. You can go through the whole scriptures and stuff. There's a lot of prophecies we can go through. I even believe prophecy right now, if you go to Revelation, it also talks about a one world government, a one world monetary system. I've talked to atheists that have never read Revelation, and they totally agree with me on that we're moving towards a one world monetary system, the mark of the beast, etc. On objective values, on his worldview of atheism, he said he disagrees. He doesn't believe rape is wrong. You heard it come right out of his mouth. That's what he said. He said, and I agree with him on this argument, on the cosmological argument, he said the Big Bang Theory doesn't say the universe wasn't created. And that's true. It doesn't say that it wasn't created. But that part him and I agree with. That was my point exactly. But he doesn't deny the premise of creation, and he didn't give another cause for the creation of the universe. So he doesn't disagree with what I said, and he doesn't supply another argument. So the cosmological argument goes on my side of the debate. Him and I disagree. He thinks there's nothing wrong with rape. I think it is objectively wrong. So you can judge for yourself which worldview is more trustworthy. Now, on the ontological argument, he skipped that. On the empty tomb, Jesus Christ, etc., I think he skipped that. I'm pretty sure he did. On prophecy, you said something about global disasters affect the world. And I would agree with that, but that has nothing to do with prophecies coming true. Now, another thing, I'm surprised how much Simon agrees with me and I agree with him on things. He said that DNA, we talked about it being a language, and he said, quote, we can create language. Now, I want to ask everyone in this room, what's the key phrase here in debate? He said, we can create language. What's the key phrase I'm going to talk about there? Create. Of course we can create. And Simon even said it, create. Exactly. And Simon, I agree with you. We can create language. Things that are created are the product here of intelligent design. My motorcycle was created, product of intelligent design. We're doing this debate in a conference room, the product of intelligent design. If we create language, that's you and I creating it, also the product of intelligent design. Therefore, adding the argument that DNA is a product of intelligent design on my side of the argument, he doesn't refute that. So DNA goes on our side of the argument. Now, what I was really looking for was some type of argument that would show that atheism is true. But in fact, Simon had said, before we started the debate, he said that he does believe that God can't exist. So let's go through this. Have we heard any reasons to think that God doesn't exist? No. And Simon would be honest and say that he didn't give any reasons why we should believe God doesn't exist. But we did go through a lot of reasons why we should know that God does exist. And a lot of them Simon agreed with me on. I'm looking here. Oh, on the question where I said, what proof and evidence can you provide that shows atheism is actually correct? He honestly and accurately said there is no proof that atheism is correct. There's none. So on Simon's side, we heard zero arguments against God's existence. On my side, we went through mind-body dualism. That's number one. We talked about the universe having to have a cause that is not a material cause. We talked about that. He didn't really give a reason what he believes could cause a universe. In fact, he said, yeah, the Big Bang Theory doesn't say the universe wasn't created. So the cosmological argument goes on our side of the debate. Mind, he agrees with me on that we have a mind. You heard him say it. I'm recording it. Ghost demonic activity. Simon, what did you say? Well, when you get back on, you can talk about ghost demonic activity. I think you said something like you've had, oh no, you were talking about out-of-body experiences. You know friends that had near-death experiences or something. Ghost demonic activity, we talked about that. I asked people in the room, and I believe the people here are telling the truth. They said they've had experience with that, and they know people that do. So we haven't heard any reasons to think that God doesn't exist. I went through at least 10 reasons to think that God does. None of them are refuted. All of them still stand strong. And most of them, he just came out and agreed with me. And I would like to tell you, Simon, you should just become a Christian. I want to say this, and then Simon, you can get back on and stuff. But I want to tell you guys something here. And if I could use the whiteboard for this, just to give you guys your money's worth, I want you to check this out here. I want you to pretend that all of us here, we're at a crossroads, and there's two paths here that we could take, okay? And let's say one path leads to atheism, okay? And let's say the path on the right leads to Christianity, okay? Now, let's put A over here. Simon, you'll agree with this, I think, my friend. You seem like a pretty sharp guy. If we're honest and we're going where the evidence leads, we would all agree that the evidence leads towards Christianity in this debate. However, let's just say, for sake of discussion, that 50% of the weight of the arguments is on the side of atheism. I certainly don't agree with that. I believe that the, 100% of the arguments was on the side of Christianity in this debate. And my atheist friend and opponent even admits that God can exist, and he admits that there is no proof and evidence that atheism is accurate and correct. But let's just say, for sake of argument, that 50% of the weight of the argument leans towards atheism and 50% leans towards Christianity. He already admitted that atheism ends in death. But the Christian worldview says you're going to have eternal life. You're not going to go to hell on the Christian worldview. You're going to have joy unimaginable, forgiveness for sins. My atheist opponent flat out admitted that atheism leads in death. That's what it leads to, just leads to death. If you're at a crossroads and 50% of the argument leads towards one way and 50% leads towards the other, the rational conclusion is Christianity, isn't it? You are rational to choose the path of Christianity. I had a debate, Simon, you'll like this. I had a debate with this guy from the UK, and he admitted, he goes, yeah, you won the debate. You gave more arguments for your side, and you backed them up and stuff. And he said, yes, I would agree. This is what he said. He said, I would agree that if the arguments are weighed in each other's favor, 50% on the side of atheism, 50% for Christianity, the rational man or woman will choose Christianity. But what we saw tonight, guys, Simon's an intelligent guy. He's sharp and stuff. But you notice atheism lacks proof and evidence. It lacks good arguments. It's really a faith-based worldview. It is the atheist that believes in a view that is based on faith, not evidence. All evidence shows that the universe had a beginning. You know, Bård Gustav Lincoln, three very famous cosmologists say that the universe definitely had a beginning. All evidence leads there. I ask you guys, what do you think makes more sense that created the universe? Nothing? Anthony Kinney of Oxford University says if someone's an atheist, they must believe the universe came from nothing and by nothing. But that's madness. That's worse than magic. At least with magic, you got a rabbit, a hat, and a magician. What makes more sense? Nothing created the universe, or a powerful God created the universe? Every single rational person is going to say God is more rational than nothing doing it. Nothing is the absence of anything. So you are rational to choose Christianity even if both sides of the argument are weighed 50%. I think it's obviously clear that Christianity is the more rational, plausible conclusion. Okay, Simon, I am going to let you pop on and then let me know what... Val, you know, it's interesting that Val said that because, you know, have you heard of Anthony Flew? Anthony Flew was an atheist, and he debated, he's very a good atheist, and he came to admit that God exists. So, and that's what Simon said. Simon said, yeah, you know, I believe that God can exist, but given the ontological argument that I gave at the beginning, in a debate format, you have to show that it's impossible for God to exist, because if someone gives you the ontological argument that shows that even if it's possible for God to exist, then God exists in the actual world, what Simon basically said is, yes, God exists, given the ontological argument. Simon, anything else you want to chat about before we go? I'll let you have the last word.
Well, first of all, I'm confused because I don't remember saying that God does exist. Personally, this is the first debate I've ever been in, so I just wanted to get my ideas out there. Thank you for giving me the opportunity. It made me better at presenting my own ideas. Yep, I would agree. You won the argument, but the difference is I'm not trying to change anyone's ideas here. I just want to express my own and get better at it. And I've actually been brought up as my whole family has been Catholic, and most of them still are. I don't necessarily completely believe either way that there isn't a God or there is, but I want to say that even though it might be more rational in our way of thinking to choose Christianity based on this debate, rationality is really an impossible thing to attain because we are entirely dependent on our own thoughts. So, if you have a machine and you want to know if it's accurate, then you can't really use that machine or the person who created it to say that it's accurate. You have to use an objective source. But when it comes to humanity, there is no objective source. If we could go to a god, that would be wonderful. Personally, I haven't had any ghost or demonic or... any kind of deity interaction, so I'm not going. I'm all of you that are Christian. I say keep being Christian. That's your way of life. You must be comfortable with that. So keep doing what you're doing. I just want to tell people what I think. And yes, I have prayed before. No, I'm not seeking God. Princess. So, beyond that, thanks for having me here, and I'll talk to you guys later if I ever.
Hey, Simon. No, thanks for coming. I really appreciate coming here. I hope you guys have a nice Thanksgiving. You know, I used to be an atheist myself, and I was taken to the Catholic Church as a kid. But I have a lot of friends that are Catholics, and I've talked to them personally, and they are very nice people and stuff. But just me personally, I guess it was the church I was taken to, they never really taught the Bible. Can I just ask everyone else here, has anyone here ever been to the Catholic Church, and have you gone to what's called Mass, you know, where they say sit, stand, kneel, and they don't really do like a Bible study? And so, okay, Princess was, okay, yeah, and I love Catholics. I know Catholics that are actually saved. They believe in the essentials of Christianity. Okay, a lot of you have. Okay, great. Simon, can I give you something that I think you're gonna find epic? Do you have like an MP3 player? I know most of you guys don't have an MP3 player, but who here has an MP3 player? You do? Oh my gosh, Simon, you're gonna love this, man. Okay, here's what you guys do. Simon, go to when you go to shotgunowl.net, right? I'm gonna give you a couple of pages. You, Simon, you are gonna be dangerous how sharp you'll become. I'm still learning myself, also, Simon. I'm still educating myself. But when you go to shotgunowl.net, go to Apologetics 365, I believe. How many of you guys have been to Apologetics 365? And what you can do, Simon, is you could download these MP3s on science, philosophy, the historicity of Jesus Christ, and DNA, and it's epic. And you could load them on your MP3 player. Sometimes I'm going to sleep and I listen to that as I go to sleep. Another thing you could do when you go to shotgunowl.net, go to the music, hey Nan, podcast area, Apologetics 315. Thanks, John. I know it didn't sound right when I was typing it. Yeah, Apologetics 315. It's right there at shotgunowl.net. You go to the music podcast area. But I think the thing, because you kind of remind me a little of me, Simon. You kind of, have the same type of personality, where you're pretty easygoing and, you're a nice, very charming person that does good voice imitations. I want you guys to listen to me. This is Bill Clinton. Simon, listen, I told you don't debate Shock. Every damn time people debate him, they always say he won the debate. The guy's starting to get full of himself, if you ask me. Anyways, Simon, if you go to shotgunout.net and you go to the music podcast area, they got these MP3s there that you could download. And oh, hold on, Simon. Christopher Watkins here. He wants to say something about the debate you and I had. Go ahead, Christopher Watkins. I thought the debate was good. It was pretty good. Simon, be a good Christian. But he's got to leave atheism. Atheism's not too good. Doesn't have enough cowbell. All right. Simon and I. Oh yeah, I will, J3. I have to do a Skype call right here. But can I just compliment Simon? Simon says, like the way I say that, Simon says that he does agree that Christianity won this debate. Simon says that yes, if you're at a crossroads and half the evidence is on the side of atheism and half is on the side of Christianity, you're more rational to choose Christianity. Simon says that Christianity won this debate. But Simon, seriously, man, you should check out shotgunowl.net and download a bunch of those things on your MP3. Dude, they're epic. They're absolutely epic. All you guys should do that. All right, guys, here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna go pour some coffee. Oh, Simon, would you do me a favor, man, because you're pretty cool. Would you try to get more of your atheist friends in here? To come in here and did you enjoy your stay here, Simon? Do you guys you want to give Simon a round of applause? Simon, yeah, see if you can get look at what's going on, sir. Oh well, that's good to know. Look at Simon's look at Simon's typing it. Well, that's good to know. You know, Simon, you just come up with a very good atheist bumper sticker. The new atheist bumper sticker. Just so you know, I don't promote rape. That's the new atheist bumper sticker. And most of my friends are Christian. Oh, Simon, Can I just tell you something? Because I don't want you to be shocked. Sometimes there's this atheist that comes in and he has dyslexia. And he gets very mad at Princess and J3. And he keeps telling them, prove to me dog doesn't exist. Prove to me dog doesn't exist. And we go, what do you mean? He goes, well, I have dyslexia. I meant God. I go, oh. Before I go, because I had a Skype call, do you guys want to hear me imitate Princess's voice? Okay, here's Princess.
Shuck, I think we're pretty much tired of hearing you now. I think you need to go, and let me just say this to you, Shuck, in the nicest way I can say it. Don't let the door hit you where the good Lord split you. Bye, Shucky. Go have cake or pie.
Oh, you're not hearing? Oh, okay. All right, hey, J3, I'm really going to get off now, and let me go pour some coffee, and then I'll be on. I promise I'll fire up Skype in like 3 minutes.